Our speaker is Kevlin Henney, independent consultant, speaker, writer, and trainer, co-authors of books on patterns, and columnist for various C++-oriented magazine. He's also been a member of C++ ISO C++ committee and contributed to Boost libraries. You can easily guess that his main interests are in patterns and good programming practices. And today he will present thinking outside the synchronization quadrant. Please give a warm welcome to Kevlin Henney.
Okay, good morning. The image here depicts locking. He said to turn your mobile phones off. You don't have to turn your mobile phones off. You can tweet. It's okay. You know, this is good. My name is very internet friendly and somewhat unique. And as mentioned, I'm interested in programming practice. I edited this book a few years ago, 97 Things Every Programmer Should Know. I will refer to a couple of the articles in this a little later. And also my interest in patterns. Now, these are two books which contain the words software architecture in the title. So obviously that means I'm fully qualified to talk about software architecture because I've published books with the words in the title. So what do we mean by that? And how does this relate to concurrency? I mean, there is always the question of architecture. We often think of architecture being primarily structural. But in software, what do we mean by structure? And it turns out that what we mean by structure is not as obvious as files and classes and choices of functions and components and so on. That is obviously in some way structural, but it's metaphorical. It's not real structure. It's not structure you can kick, although sometimes you wish you could. Really, in software, what we're looking at, and this is one of the most useful definitions I've ever found, is from Grady Booch. Architecture represents the significant design decisions that shape a system, where significant is measured by cost of change. Another way of looking at that is simply answering the question, how easy is something to change? And if it's not easy, then guess what? It's architectural. If you find that you say, you know, it'd be really good if we could do that, and everybody looks at you and says, you must be mad, the thing you've just suggested was architectural. Okay? When people say, you can't change that, it's architectural. Okay? When you make something, you break it. You break somebody else's code, and that somebody is not on your team, and it causes lots of systems to fail, that was probably architectural as well. This is where concurrency fits in. Because it turns out that concurrency is not simply a bolt-on property. Sometimes people have this attitude, even if they don't, you know, you never ask somebody, well, I've encountered a couple of people who think this, but most people, if you go up to them and say, oh, is concurrency just something you can add to a code base? Most people go, ah, that's a stupid idea. No, of course it isn't. Yet, actually lurking deep in your mind, there is this suspicion that it might be. You just don't know it. And this is the problem. This unfortunately informs the way we structure systems and many of the surprises that we get when we introduce any form of concurrency. And quite frankly, the way that most people go about architecture, this is not surprising. So what is the problem here? So concurrency. I did this a few years ago, running a couple of workshops. I gave people a word association game. And, you know, a word association game is something like you say black, somebody says white. You say up, and you say down. You know, it's the first word that comes into your head. Maybe it's an opposite, maybe it's not. Yeah, if you say snow, white, that would be a kind of a good example of a non-opposite. So I tried this with a couple of groups, one of whom was actually quite advanced when it came to thinking about concurrency in their system. And I said, concurrency. The first thing they said, threads. Without fail. Even the advanced group. And said, yeah, immediately, yeah, you've got to throw threads at your code. Okay, so I tried another one. Threads. Locks. Locks or synchronization. It's like, even when we know, it's still buried deep in there. You need to catch people by surprise, and they say this stuff. And you say things like, well, is explicit threading in your code the right idea? It's not that you don't have threads, it's just that threads are a very powerful construct. They are basically the go-to of concurrency. And I mean that in both a deep sense and a supremely shallow sense. The shallow sense is that if you have raw threads all over the place, this is probably not a great idea. The deeper sense is that ultimately when we look at things, just as with go-tos, you go and look at your compiled code, all those beautiful ifs and whiles and fors compiles down to things that are just plain jump statements, just go-tos. But it's a primitive. In other words, it's something that lives at a lower level. But it's also an observation that is based on, there was a proof in the 1970s that for sequential programming, go-to is the most powerful construct. And what was meant by the most powerful construct is that you can express anything else in terms of it. Whether you want to use it in the raw form is another question, and I'd suggest no. But it's the idea that it is powerful in that sense. So threads are a little bit like this. Okay, they can be as messy as a go-to, but they're also as powerful in a primitive sense. But when you ask a lot of people, why are you threading? They say, oh, we want to go faster. Locks are the anti-thread. The whole purpose of locks is to eliminate concurrency. That is their point. Okay? But people don't think of it like that. They think of it in terms of, oh, well, we now need to synchronize because we need to be safe. So we end up with this observation. This was made about building architecture, but quite frankly, sometimes the way that people construct their systems. But actually, I want to go beyond architecture as the art of how to waste space. Sometimes it's the art of how to waste time. So this talk is entitled Thinking Outside the Synchronization Quadrant. So I need to show you what the synchronization quadrant is. I'm going to give you a very simple quadrant diagram. Quadrant diagrams are great because, you know, they kind of divide the universe into four. There's two axes, you know, and there's only two things on each axis. And normally there's one quadrant that's very, very good or one quadrant that's very, very bad, and it kind of simplifies things for everybody. And so what I've done is I've basically characterized the relationship between basically code and data, or rather code in threads and the data in threads. Is the data mutable? Can I change that data? If the answer is yes, then it is mutable. If the answer is no, it is immutable. Okay. Is the data shared between different threads? If the answer is yes, then it's shared. If the answer is no, it's unshared. Okay. And so, very simple idea. And so, therefore, we kind of create this simple map. Now, just to clarify for you where the bad stuff is, where the good stuff is, three quarters of the diagram is really easy to program in. One quarter is where everybody programs in. All the pain you are feeling is in the top right-hand corner. What are you doing there? Get out of it. Okay, this is the synchronization quadrant. This is where, in your code, you will need synchronization. Now, I'm not saying you don't need synchronization in the other cases. What I'm saying is that synchronization is hidden. That synchronization either does not exist or is hidden and commoditized from you. In the top right-hand corner, you have to care about it. In the other three quadrants, you either do not need it or you don't need to worry about it. Okay? The top right-hand corner is the synchronization quadrant. Now, how do we end up with all our code in the top right-hand corner? This is where all the pain happens. I mean, this is when you talk to people, you sort of say, why have you got locks if you wanted performance? And they say, well, safety. And they say, well, why did you create unsafe code? Yeah, so it's not always clear. There's an assumption that people have. And I often ask people, and in fact, I did this with one team I did some consultancy for a few years ago. And they said, I said, so hang on, explain to me, and this is a kind of a good trick, but you've got to be careful with it. I played dumb, which, you know, my kids think is quite easy for me to do. My older boy is a teenager, so he thinks anything that comes out of his parents' mouths is automatically stupid. So I played dumb. I said, so why have you got all these locks? And they're kind of looking at me. Well, we need locks because we've got threads. Well, yeah, but why do you need the locks? Well, because we're sharing data. I still don't see why you need the locks. And I said, well, you know, because otherwise it's unsafe. Well, why is it unsafe? You're sharing data between threads. There's nothing unsafe about that. And they're really looking at each other. Yeah, but what if the data changes? And it's just like, whoa, hang on. Where did that piece of information come from? That was the most important thing you told me, yet it was the last thing you told me. You opened with, we're using locks. You did not open with, we have mutable data. Let's challenge and question that. Okay? So in other words, it's so deeply embedded, people think that when you have data, you're allowed to change it. Where did that idea come from? Changing data is a privilege, it's not a right. Okay? You have to make a really good case for it. I would actually say that about sequential code anyway, but the question is, how do we end up here? And it's very easy to see how we ended up here. Because historically, where did all code live? Before threads became common, all code was by definition on the left-hand side, in the unshared thing, because if you only have one thread, you cannot share it, and so therefore it's automatically safe. Although sometimes I see a lot of code where actually one thread is one too many. But that aside, the point here is that over here it becomes a matter of machine efficiency and history. And historically, we have chosen to be very imperative about how we view code. And there's a very, 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 very good historical reasons based on resource availability, compiler technology, and so on. So naturally, we didn't just gravitate to the left-hand side, we gravitated to the top left-hand side. So when we added concurrency, all we did was move right from where we were. And unfortunately, that took us straight into the synchronization quadrant. So I want to start looking at the properties of a system to really try and understand where it is that the presence of concurrency and surprises and our assumptions of threading and locks make our life difficult and are also inappropriate. So systems have properties. This is a very trivial observation, and we can use other words. You know, when you've got a when you're dealing with the system, you can talk about its capabilities, its features, its characteristics, however you want to frame this. And it has these inside and out. And importantly, what I want to characterize here is the idea of the properties of the running system and the properties of the code base, the inside. What are these properties? Now, yesterday I presented a very simple way of looking at the properties of a system. Can I have just a quick show of hands, who was in my talk yesterday? Okay, so a reasonable number of you. So you've seen this before. It's these fingers, okay? For those of you who are not there, it's a simple right-hand rule for organizing the properties of your code to get us away from the utterly pointless and meaningless vocabulary of non-functional. The point is we have functional properties, the semantics of our code, okay? What it does, and also this is where the functionality bugs live. If you have a bug, it's a deficit on your functionality axis. We promised you this functionality, but you've got this. There's a shortfall, okay? The operational axis, how it runs, its performance characteristics, for example. And then the developmental qualities. Tell me about the code. Is it easy to be in the code? Is it easy to work with the code? Does the code resist your changes? So we want architecture to enable the top, support that, and allow us to live in there, basically. So let's look at each axis in turn from the point of view of concurrency and our threading assumptions. So first of all, let's look at operational. And there is there's this very simple idea. Operational is concerned with the constraints, the runtime. So Shakespeare had this one down in Troilus and Cressida. Turns out Shakespeare was actually a software developer a few centuries ahead of time, admittedly, but he carefully wove his software metaphors into his plays. Okay, some people think they're just plays. Look closely. Look closely. He was talking about software. Here, he says, this is the monstrosity in love, lady, that the will is infinite. This is it. We want to do so many things. We have such great imagination, all these possibilities. And the execution is confined. We are frustrated by the finite limits of our machines, but also those annoying things that they call the laws of physics. Those get in the way every now and then. It turns out that the speed of light is not a configuration value that you can change. Okay, that's disappointing. And the desire is boundless. What we want to do has no end, potentially, and the act a slave to limit. So this is what the operational axis is about. Now, first of all, let us understand when people introduce just basic threading. Let's just take just basic threading. There's a very simple idea, the idea of multitasking, preemptive multitasking. And we can confine ourselves to the idea of a single core for a moment. And there is, even in the single core era, people were still using concurrency. And there are reasons for using concurrency, but they are not primarily performance. They're actually decoupling between temporal orderings in your code. But there is a cost. It is also a cost that we bear in multi-core systems, and people often overlook it. Now, and actually, one of the best places I found that described this was a thing called the Clue Train Manifesto from the late 90s. So this was actually nothing to do with what I'm talking about directly. This was to do with really rethinking business online. And it's a surprisingly good volume. But there's a point in here that is made specifically by David Weinberger And he's talking about multitasking in humans. But he's also, it turns out, what he says is directly relevant to our perceptions of multitasking within our operating systems. Multitasking is really just rapid attention switching. Humans can't really do this. Okay, you're rubbish at multitasking. In fact, it turns out there's research that demonstrates that if you think you're good at multitasking, you're actually worse at multitasking than somebody who doesn't think they're good at it. Okay? So if you ask somebody on your team, say, anybody here good at, you know, multitasking lots of things? I've got lots of bits of work. Whoever puts their hand up, don't give them the work. Okay? So, but it's rapid attention switching. What you're doing is you're focusing, your executive is focusing on that, and then it's focusing on that. But as he observes, that'd be a useful skill, except it takes us a second or two to engage in a new situation. In a new situation, we've graced with our focus. This is exactly the same with a preemptive model. It doesn't just cut from one to another. There is a cost. And we need to respect that. And that is also the case. And we need to keep this in mind in any system where you've got threads. And just because you've got multiple cores, they don't run somehow magically independent using magic. Okay? There's a few costs in there as well. And what he says is the sum total of attention is actually decreased. So there's a cost. We have to work out whether we're getting more for our effort than not. So there's a trade-off, and that's the important phrase. It's a very common English phrase, trade-off, but we often forget as a word what it actually means. It means you're making a trade. And when you make a trade, you want to make a good trade. I'm giving you this, what do I get in return? Yeah? I'm paying you a little bit of time for context switch, but and the costs of threading. Do I get something better in return? If the answer is yes, good trade. If the answer is no, what are you doing? Okay. As he says, and I love this, slicing your attention, in other words, is less like slicing potatoes than like slicing plums. You always end up losing juice. That's a really good way of looking at it. There's always some kind of loss. You have to offset it. So a recent blog posting from the IT here. I thought this is rather good because it says, this is a logarithmic scale. Not all CPU operations are created equal. And obviously he's talking about a number of ranges of how much this stuff costs. The link is lost at the bottom, but if you Google this, you will find it. But the things I want to, you know, so basically the relative costs of these things. He also shows distance which light travels while the operation is performed. His laptop is clearly smaller than mine because this is what I normally use this as the standard measure. This is one light nanosecond from here to here, okay? Which normally we think of the speed of light as being very fast, but one light nanosecond, that gives you a cycle time of 1 gigahertz, which doesn't sound particularly fast when you put it like that. So he's kind of shown us the relative cost. Now, the ones I want to draw your attention to are these two. Thread context switch, the direct costs, and thread context switch, the indirect costs. It is not cheap. It is not cheap, so you better be getting a really good deal, okay? This is one of those things of like, it's one of those things. I'm going to walk down the road. What are you doing? I'm going to the shop. How far is the shop? 200 meters. Okay, so are you going to walk? Well, no, I'm going to take the car. It's going to take you longer to get in the car, drive down the road, find a parking space, get out of the car than it is to actually walk. That doesn't mean the car is a bad idea. It's great if you're traveling multiple kilometers, but a few hundred meters, not really worth it. So there is this idea we always do trade-offs. We just need to keep thinking of that while we're working with code. And there are a number of other costs. Let's just say we start thinking, well, I've got multi-cores and so on. And I'm going to run my threads. Well, it's interesting. I stumbled across the fact that I had slides for this, but from a slightly different context, but it turns out they serve exactly the same purpose. So how long does something take to do? This is the completion time for a single thread, T1. Okay, so let's try this. What we're going to do is we are going to division of labor. So we're going to divide up the task across multiple threads. Brilliant, we've got N times speed up, fantastic. Actually, it doesn't work like that. It turns out that it's strictly dependent on a number of factors, including the portion in parallel that you can actually achieve. Okay. This is Amdahl's law. Okay, if it turns out that you can't parallelize everything, and the nature of every task cannot be parallelized, sometimes you need to do something before you do something else. If there's lots of handoffs and wait states, then this starts going down. Okay, and then there's another one which actually I have to radically simplify because it is more complex. But what I'm going to do is I'm going to give you a basic worst case scenario. Okay, the worst case scenario here is that we're going to imagine all the threads are talking to all the other threads. Now, we might say, oh, that's terrible. Well, yes, it is, but that doesn't mean it doesn't exist. I'm sure there, you know, I've seen code that does that, and you may have encountered it. In other words, it turns out every thread is busy talking to all the other threads for something. It kind of emerged. By the way, that's a point about architecture. Significant design decisions aren't just the decisions that somebody called architect makes. It turns out that we make significant design decisions in the detail of the code all the time. Okay, so it turns out you may accidentally end up emerging with this kind of architecture that is more of an ad hoc architecture than something planned and intentional. And it turns out all the threads are talking to all the other threads. Oh, I need something from there, and I need something from there. And so, again, there's different communication costs. So I'm going to say I'm going to have to average it down to be something typical. K is more a function than a constant. But if we just take this as representative, a typical communication overhead, that is the cost of waiting. It is the cost of all of the switching and the actual locking and all the rest of it, and any data transfer that we're involved in. Okay, and that gives us a curve that looks like this. And this is kind of important because what it tells you is that every task for a given architecture, for a given software architecture, and given hardware architecture, and operating and so on and so on, for a given task, you may have an optimal range. In other words, this is the sweet spot for concurrency. The task time to get everything done is minimized. If you have fewer threads, fewer cores, then it takes longer. And obviously, if you have no threads executing, i.e. you're not running the program, it'll take infinite time. But at least you won't have any bugs. But the important thing is that as you start adding stuff, the costs can add up, and they can end up over here. So sometimes we find people over-threading. It turns out that they're slowing things down. By changing a couple of the factors on the right, you can bring this one down, but it's very difficult to get something that's perfectly scalable. So here's a very simple example. If we take a sort of map-reduce model, so just local threading, I'm not going to do map-reduce across a network, we have the idea of, okay, I've got a number of tasks, and let's say I'm going to iterate over begin to end, maybe that's a range from a vector, it doesn't really matter, but these are all things that are function objects, functional in some way. So what we've got is we've got all of these tasks to be done, and then we're going to aggregate the results. So first of all, we're going to kick off with getting our threads ready. We're going to launch all of the tasks in their own thread. So we do that, we build that up, bang, 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 hit them all off, and we're good. And then we're going to wait for everything, okay? So what we've got here is there are some costs. The cost we've accumulated is thread start and also waiting for everything, okay? Not just the cost of a join, but different tasks will take different times. So we're waiting for everybody to finish. So there are some costs there. We've already potentially lost a little bit of the value of P here. But now we're going to reduce everything. We're going to bring everything together. How that's handled is handled by the caller. But this part can't be done in parallel. So the idea is that P is going to be, you know, that's 1 minus P, and then this is effectively the parallel part. But even then, we've actually got some costs in there. And notice these threads are not talking to each other, and we've still incurred costs. So we better have some really good stuff going. Now, it really is interesting when you do this, it shows immediately how many cores you've got. If you run this on a machine with 2 cores, then you get a sweet spot at 2. 4 runs slower. Okay? This was a big surprise to some people that I ran a workshop for a couple of years back. You know, they kind of like, you could tell the number of cores. And I'd ask people, okay, let's increase the number of cores, increase the number of threads, and then find out where your best performance is. And it was really obvious going around the room. You know, the numbers were kind of like 2 and 4 or 8 in one case. So it's really quite obvious in these cases. And this is truly independent tasks that actually don't have to communicate except for synchronizing for reduce. The other thing is there is this assumption that people go, oh, yeah, we've got all this stuff and so on. And then it gets interesting, particularly when we start using the concurrency of the network. And there is, again, an assumption that needs to be challenged. It's most obviously put in this blog from last year by Adam Drake. Command line tools can be over 200 times faster than your Hadoop cluster. This guy rewrote. He basically showed just that constant reminder, the speed of light, you cannot beat it, okay? Very simply, one of the things that has changed and why you may want to consider, given that distribution is an extension of concurrency, why you want to consider things locally again is that we now have more memory available. previously, one of the reasons people would distribute stuff is because they wanted more CPU and more memory. You now have more CPU and more memory, but it happens to be within a light nanosecond. So use it. Okay. It turns out this guy was able to use shell tools locally, and it was faster than using a JIT compiled language across the network. So always keep that one in mind. It's not unconditional that things get faster when you thread them. Okay, so what about the functional axis? The functional axis, well, perhaps I should be talking about functionality. Actually, I don't want to talk about the functionality. I'm going to kind of assume that that's an obvious thing. What I want to talk about is what I referred to earlier, the deficit of functionality, bugs. Where do bugs come from? This is, you know, on the origin of bug species. Where do they come from? Do they sneak into your code in the middle of the night? Yeah, the code was fine when I left it, but overnight they kind of crept in and they're just, oh, there it is, there it is. No. John Cormack wrote this really nice blog a few years back, Functional Programming in C and C++, and a large fraction of the flaws in software development are due to programmers not fully understanding all the possible states their code may execute in. State. This is to do with, again, this idea of the data in your code, the data within your program, the state of execution. And it's not whether or not it is possible to do something, it's whether or not it is possible for you to understand it. This is what characterizes the developmental side of things, as we're going to get to it. But can I understand it? And the problem is that if we have lots of state change, then it's harder to reason about this. If we have global state, it's harder to reason about this. And as he says, in a multi-threaded environment, the lack of understanding and resulting problems are greatly amplified, almost to the point of panic, if you are paying attention. And I like this point, because he uses exactly the same wording that I've often found myself using by saying that many of the challenges that we have in terms of things like defects or reasoning about state, we already had problems, but concurrency and distribution are amplifiers. They take any small misunderstanding and really give it far more severe consequences. And these bugs are quite difficult to track down. They are quite difficult to work with. So here's the problem. You know, what is the problem with tracking state? Well, you have to read this tweet, because I can't actually read it out loud in the second. We end up with race conditions. So what do we do? Well, our natural response is ad locks. So Bartosz Smolewski has this lovely way of putting it. He says, shared memory is like a canvas where threads collaborate in painting images, except that they stand on the opposite sides of the canvas and use guns rather than brushes. The only way they can avoid killing each other is if they shout, duck, before opening fire. Welcome to lock-based architectures. Okay, this is effectively what we're doing. But I'm doing the wrong thing. I'm saying lock-based, but really what I mean is shared memory state. So so what other problems kind of emerge from this? Well, it turns out that the minute you introduce locks, one of the interesting things is you introduce the possibility for deadlock and live lock. But you introduce these possibilities. There are all kinds of exciting cases. The minute you introduce any kind of wait state, you've got possibilities of priority inversion, deadlocking, and so on. In summarizing Andrew Tannenbaum's work, there's this online course that sort of says, right, there are several ways to address the problem of deadlock. Just ignore it and hope it doesn't happen. This is a surprisingly popular approach. It's called the ostrich algorithm. You put your head in the ground and you just ignore it, okay? People often think deadlock requires detection and recovery if it happens, take action. And a remarkable amount of intellectual effort in academia and in software, and everybody goes into this. And I'm going to try and posit the fact that perhaps we're solving the wrong problem. Instead of trying to solve the wrong thing, perhaps we should be thinking differently, yeah? So we've got these other things, dynamic avoidance by careful research, check to see if a resource can be granted, and if granted, cause a deadlock, don't grant it. Again, this is another detection, but it's a little more tentative. But I like the last one, prevention. Change the rules. If you don't like the game you're playing, change the rules. If the problem is wait states, then try and get rid of your wait states. Try and reduce them. If the problem is mutually exclusive access to shared objects, either don't share them or see if you can get rid of the mutual exclusion. Now, we may not be able to do that completely, but it turns out that if you start adopting this as your philosophy, most of the challenges that people associate with concurrent programming kind of disappear. and allow you to actually focus on the essence, the idea of expressing yourself within code. So this brings us to the habitability axis, or rather developmental axis, the first aspect of which is indeed habitable, or habitability. What do I mean by habitable? Habitable is an interesting word, because what I want to do here is I want to outline some properties that we want of our code base. And one of the things is that we want it to be habitable. If we're talking about architecture, then one of the things that an architecture is a place to live. If you are a software developer, you are living in the code. You are spending your time in it. Is it habitable? Is it comfortable? And this idea of habitability comes from a book by Dick Gabriel in the late 90s, The Patterns of Software. And he had this lovely way of looking at it. He was talking about the qualities of code. And he said, well, habitability is the characteristic of source code that enables programmers coming to the code later in its life to understand its construction and intentions and to change it comfortably and confidently. Isn't that something that we want in code? You want to be able to look at code and say, I know what's going on. Yeah? Unless, of course, you're trying to keep your job and, you know, people kind of say, oh, you know, his code's easy to understand. We can get rid of him. You know, and it's just like, yeah. It's like, yeah, she writes really good code and, you know, what she's left is really decent, so we can get rid of her because, you know, everybody understands that code. It's so simple. Do you know what? It's really hard to get simple, comprehensible code. It's actually a challenge. It's a deception when we look at code and say that's easy, to think that actually solving it was easy. Sometimes these things take a remarkable amount of effort. But that is a property that we would like. It takes surprisingly little effort to make code overcomplicated, as I demonstrated in my talk yesterday. So that's what we want. We want to be able to look at a piece of code and fit it in our heads. Basically say, yeah, I understand what's going on here. I can reason about it. I can reason about its state. I can change it comfortably and confidently rather than going like, okay, don't anybody touch that piece of code now. I think it works. Okay. I think, yeah. You know, enough of this hope-based programming. Right. So this is what we're talking about. Habitability makes a place livable, like home. Okay. This is what we want in software. Developers can feel at home, place their hands on any item without having to think deeply about where it is. How can you say that about all of the code that you work on? What about testable? Okay, why is it? Testability is a really important property in code. And sometimes we go, oh, well, you know, yeah, we just test the system. We don't want a unit test. Unit testing is a waste of time. Yeah, of course it is. Simple testing can prevent most critical failures. It turns out, it's a very interesting paper from Usenix last year, or earlier this year, I can't remember the exact date, by Yuan et al., and it basically demonstrates across a number of distributed systems that over 3/4 of the errors could have been detected using unit tests. So, yeah, testability makes a difference. And normally what we do is we say, well, you know, the code is too difficult to unit test. Ah, that's different. That doesn't mean you don't want to unit test. You're just stating a problem that you have. I want to state that we want our code to be unit testable. And that's great. So we're done. We want our code to be unit testable. What is a unit test? It's all very well saying, you know, I want this property, but what does it mean to have that property? So it turns out there are a number of different definitions. So Michael Feathers has this very formal definition, or no, enumerative definition from a few years back, a set of unit testing guidelines, a set of unit testing rules, sorry. A test is not a unit test if it talks to the database, it communicates across the network, it touches the file system, it can't run at the same time as any of your other unit tests. So you have to do special things to your environment, such as editing config files to run it. A lot of people get very disappointed when I put that definition up because they're kind of going like, ah, we have no unit tests. Damn. The point here is that it also makes assumptions about your execution model. It's not just about the network. Let's look at it from a different point of view. This is the definition that I presented 9 years ago on the register. It's a very formalized definition, but a unit test is a test of behavior whose success or failure is wholly determined by the correctness of the test and the correctness of the unit under test. If your test fails because of a network failure, then your code may well be correct, and your test may well be correct, but the test has failed for reasons other than the correctness of the code. Okay? If your code fails because of the way that concurrency has been scheduled in your operating system, that is not to do directly with the correctness of your code and the correctness of the unit under test. It is an external factor. The scheduling is beyond your control in that sense, unless, of course, you're writing the operating system. So let's put it another way. What are our requirements for testability from another point of view? I've given a formal definition here. Let's turn it into something slightly more useful. What do we want from unit tests? If I ask people, what would you like from your unit tests? They often say, when a unit test passes, it shows the code is correct. I've got some really bad news for you. That's never going to work. Okay? You cannot guarantee that the code is correct just by testing it. Okay? Hey, look, my multi-threaded test, it passed today. That one time I ran it. And then every now and then it fails mysteriously. The point here is that you cannot test for the absence of bugs, only their presence. Okay? Dijkstra observed that first. But this is really important because a lot of people come to me and say, how do you test? How do you unit test multi-threaded code? My general answer is you can't. And they're very disappointed because what they're looking for is a magic solution. And sadly, I'm all out of magic. Okay? That's just not a thing that we have in the world. Magic is a thing that they make up. Okay? It's not real. Unit tests, what you want to do is organize your code so that the parts that you want to unit test are not, are they either fully contain their concurrency, so pure SIMD parallelism, and pure computational-based parallelism, and therefore commoditized in a library. They either contain it completely, or you're dealing with units of execution that are not themselves concurrent, and that the architecture organizes the concurrency around them, so that you can unit test this, but integration test the coordination of them. It turns out that what you want from your unit tests is when a unit test fails, it shows the code is incorrect. Now, it turns out there's a lot of unit tests that fail when the code is actually correct, but this is a good start. So how do we get such code? Because the point is that we want the code to be habitable and we want to know and change it in confidence. That means that the way we write our code should involve isolation. And we have many units of isolation, objects, functions, and so on. But use these units aggressively and properly. Isolate concepts from one another. We're going to use this stuff asynchronously. Okay? Asynchronous suggests that we either eliminate or reduce severely the amount of locking in the code, or to be precise, the amount of blocking. Okay, that's the thing I'm more interested in, is the blocking. It's locking manifests itself as a form of blocking. Now, you can't always eliminate all forms of blocking. Sometimes people say, oh, we've got a weight-free architecture. That's great, except what you find is that what people mean is your code has to be busy for it to be truly weight-free. If your code is not busy, then you end up with lots of busy spin cycles. Okay, the idea is that what we're actually saying is there are certain tasks where you do actually have to wait because you have nothing else to do, and that is a natural consequence of things. What we want to do is eliminate the ones that are not necessary. So asynchronicity is an important property, and interestingly, so sequential. So I'm talking about concurrency, and yet I'm saying actually sequential code is what we want. So this is almost a paradox in the sense of what I want is sequential code. I don't want concurrent code. I want sequential code because sequential code is easier to reason about. So how do we kind of resolve this? Well, the idea is that the things that are asynchronous are internally sequential. Okay, and we basically, wherever you are in the code base, everything looks sequential. You should not see that there are threads running, except perhaps at the point that you launch them. But wherever you are in the code base, it should look around you, yep, looks like a single-threaded world to me. Okay, that's how it should feel. It turns out, in other words, what we're after is not a virtual multiprocessor, but a virtual uniprocessor. It turns out you're very familiar with this architecture. You just don't know it. This, your stream of consciousness, is a virtual uniprocessor. Your brain is massively parallel. But you have the illusion of things happening in sequence in your head. It's a very sweet illusion. It's not what's going on at all. But it looks and feels sequential. An idea may pop in. That was, an observation may pop in, a feeling may pop in, a desire to do something may pop in. These are all just events delivered to your single thread of consciousness. And you think, oh, this is how the world is, this is how I think. Not at all. It's a beautiful abstraction over a very complex hardware. So what we're talking about here is effectively the idea in some cases our architectures satisfy what we might say, or the problems satisfy what we might say is an asynchronous invocation. I would like to execute a function but not have to wait for its result. But how am I going to get its result? Well, at this point, we can go into the pattern space a little bit, sort of say, well, what I need is a future. What I'm going to do is I'm going to execute a function asynchronously, because I don't actually want to go and have to pick up the result manually from and mess about with mutexes. So I'm going to say I do want some waiting, but I want to minimize the waiting, and I want to commoditize it and make it as simple and transparent as possible. So there is non-interference during the execution of something. So this idea of asynchronicity is strong. A future is the idea of it's a proxy, it's a virtual proxy. The idea of futures, sometimes known as IOUs, you return, instead of a value from a function, you return a placeholder. And then when you need it, you can block on it. Okay? But you can also ask it, by the way, are you ready yet? So if you want to truly avoid all wait states, if you have something else to do. If you have nothing else to do, then waiting is a natural consequence. Now, in C++11, there is we have this kind of stuff in here. We've got a standard future, we've got an async thing, and we've got that. A number of years ago, I put forward a proposal that I still think is more elegant. Obviously, I do, because I put it forward. That was actually based on the idea that everything in a function library, sorry, a threading library, should follow a standardized and simplified metaphor. And the metaphor was a function. So instead of having get a future object that you use get on, the idea was to take a slightly different route and say everything is like a function. So instead of saying async, the idea is that you thread a function. So thread is a verb. You thread a function. What that returns is a function object. So in other words, everything is a function. Everything can be called. When you want the result of the function object, you call it like a function. Okay. So in other words, it's a much more uniform, simplified model. So you can pass it around as if it's a function object. And when you call it, it will give you that. So it fits with all the other kinds of ideas. The use of dot get, not my favorite really. This idea was a much, much deeper idea. Now there's something else here. Not every task can be turned into an asynchronous plus rendezvous structure. So we have to talk about immutability, because effectively what we did in the previous one is we isolated change. The asynchronous function could change as much as it liked as long as it didn't interfere with the function that was the caller. Okay, so in other words, true isolation, unshared data, you can have as much mutability as you want. But another axis is to consider the axis of no change. Let us have data and not change it. In functional programming, so this is from the source of all true functional programming wisdom, obviously, the Haskell homepage. That's what the Haskell programmers would have you believe. In functional programming, programs are executed by evaluating expressions. Okay? This is in contrast with the styles that we use in imperative programming, where programs are composed of statements which change global state when executed. Now, let me clarify what I mean by global state. I don't mean global variables. They don't mean global variables. What they mean is state that can be shared between any parts of the program. So there's this idea of modification of global state. Unfortunately, it's a shame they use the term global there, because normally for us, global, you know, for everybody else in the programming business, global normally is a scope-related concept, whereas they're actually talking about overall program state. Functional programming typically avoids using mutable state. And they observe, you know, this is the important thing, it's not game over, because they say, well, you know, many programming languages support programming in both functional and imperative styles, and I'm going to say C++ can support both, and I've done a number of talks on functional C++. But the idea is the syntax and facilities of a language are typically optimized for one of these styles. There's a lot in C++ that kind of resists you doing that. And importantly, you may find your existing code base resists this kind of philosophy. Social factors and coding conventions will often force you to one of these styles. Now, the problem is that when you say to a lot of C++ programmers, hey, functional programming, the first thing they think of is, oh, lambdas. I'm not going to say that that's not the case. I think programming with lambdas is, I'm so not object-oriented anymore, I'm doing lambdas. I've got really bad news for you. Lambda calculus was the first object-oriented language. This is an observation that William Cook makes in his talk and paper on Understanding Data Abstraction Revisited. Now, he dates it to 1941. He's wrong. It's 1932. So basically, when people get terribly excited about programming in lambdas in C++ 11 onwards, welcome to the 1930s. Yeah, so really it's nothing to do with it. Yes, it is related to functional programming, but actually if you go and look more deeply at object orientation from a theoretical perspective, but also a few other languages, Smalltalk and so on, you'll find that the idea of being able to pass a piece of code around as an object is kind of very object-oriented indeed. So just using lambdas does not make you a functional programmer. On the other hand, we do have some delights in the C++ syntax. I mean, that's actually valid C++. Okay? Or like that. I did not pay him to say that. So this is this is a lambda that takes no arguments, has no capture, and does nothing, and returns nothing. And this is executing it to really do nothing. So, you know, hey, great. Yeah, I know, this is the thing, is like sometimes it's the case like, right, how far can we take this? What string of parentheses can I make legal? Yeah? I leave. It's disappointing, isn't it? Yeah. But it still does not prevent you from rising to the challenge in other ways. I mean, yeah, what string of punctuation can you get that is legal? Oh, that's a good question. Somebody, if somebody's bored with this talk, go and kick off GCC and find out. Okay. So anyway, what we really want to do is a better philosophy of functional programming. Michael Feathers observed this a few years ago, which I thought was a very good way of reasoning about it. Object orientation makes code understandable by encapsulating moving parts. What you want to do is co-locate and modularize the mechanics. Functional programming makes code understandable by minimizing the moving parts. So they both have a philosophy of moving parts. One is containment and the other is reduction. And we see that this can be a very practical mechanism. This is not just a localized, simple mechanism. It's a deeply practical one. This one from Facebook describing their the implementation of Facebook Moments. To keep our C++ API boundary simple, we adopted one-way data flow. Now, there's an important point about one-way data flow. First of all, with one-way data flow, as they say, the API consists of methods to perform fire and forget actions. Okay, so basically, the idea, these actions can mutate data. So the idea is that one-way data flow, what does that mean? It means no callbacks. One-way data flow, no callbacks. If you have locking and callbacks, you're inviting deadlock, live lock, and all kinds of exciting problems related to that. Because you're basically saying, here is a piece of code that is locked, and then I'm going to go out, and then I'm going to come back into it. What is the state related between these two parts? It can get very exciting, in a bad way, just to let you know. So the idea is one-way data flow. Now, that has an important effect. It gives us an isolation effect. We can say, there are changes, but they are not visible to other parts. So the thing is, half the trick is, where there are changes, isolate them. Eliminate them from public view. Do not share them. What they found is they eliminated, they chose a style of execution, eliminated problems as they perceived them, but kept to a really strong core functional style. And where there was a bottleneck, they optimized it, but the idea was to keep the illusion of a pure functional model, do clever caching if there are any issues, don't solve the problem at the wrong level of abstraction. Right. This gives us this idea that sometimes the way we can solve some of these things is by using explicitly immutable objects. An immutable value, its instances are immutable, the internal state of the value is set at construction, never changes, no subsequent modifications are allowed. Now in C++, we have further support for this idea in const, except here we have to start saying, when I say const, I really do mean it. It's not just logical constness, it's physical constness. Now, to avoid too much copying, we'll often do this in conjunction with passing things by reference. And we can take advantage of our value references and move semantics so that we are able to support the illusion that we are just communicating with values. And the idea is that there's an awful lot of optimization that we can do behind the scenes. But also there's another side to this. It turns out that making things immutable is not the only way of isolating them. Copying is another technique for isolating things. So a copying approach is also something that is very instinctive and natural in C++. It's a very natural thing. The default way of passing an object, if you put no other syntax, is to pass it by copying. define a value object whose type whose instances are copyable. When a value is used in communication with another thread, ensure the value is copied. And this is something that is very easy to do in C++. The idea is that you are improving encapsulation either by using immutability or by using copying. If I offer you access to a value that is not going to change, and you have reference or pointer-based access to that value, then I have enforced the encapsulation within the object of origin, because you can't change anything about that object to change my view of it. The other thing is that I can give you a copy of that object, and you can change that copy as much as you like, but you can't change my view of the object that it originated that. So there is this idea that copying is another technique that sits side by side with immutability for improving encapsulation and isolation. Now, we can apply copying to very simple, apply this philosophy to very simple classes. So date classes, given that people are always getting date classes wrong as an abstraction. I've left out the defaulted operators. I'll just concentrate on the regular copying operators, but the... So a typical way that I've seen people go about doing date classes is like, right, okay, we'll have get year, get month, get day and month, set year, set month, set day and month. They have this kind of pairing of getters and setters. Really, there is no rule out there that says you have to have a getter and a setter pair. And in fact, the way that people often do it is they end up with data members. They think inside out. We'll have some data members, and then I'll provide a getter for each one. And because I've got a getter, I will provide a setter. And in fact, they even have their editors set up to do the wrong thing for them. Yeah, you can now optimize doing the wrong thing. Okay? Just like, that's great. Computers can make you do the wrong thing faster. So it's this kind of thinking. In fact, I have come across a company where that was one of their coding guidelines. For every data member you have a getter and a setter. It's just like, no. Now, the point is you don't change dates individually. You don't take a date and then modify just its month or just it. That's not how we reason about them. There is no symmetry. The problem here is that we often assume that because you have a get, there's a natural set. And the problem is in English, get and set rhyme and they have the same number of letters and everybody think, oh, look, it's a natural opposite. No, it's not a natural opposite. The opposite of set is reset or unset. It is not get. So let's get rid of those. Well, that simplifies things. Let's unify this and basically recognize that if you're going to modify something, then you modify it altogether. I set it to a new date. But if we look closely, it turns out we've already got a function that creates and validates a new date. It's called a constructor. So we don't need to set it at all. We can do this and manually do that, but actually we can do it like this. I've got a constructor and I've got copying operation. Now, the constructor does all the validation. So now I've got all the validation code in one place rather than in two places. Okay, the compiler can do all the rest of the optimization here. So we can do it like that, and we can just put curly brackets. We can do it like this. We've got a lot of choices about how we present this. The idea is that because you already know how to construct it, you've already solved the problem. All you need, and notice what we've done is we've actually reduced the mutability of this interface. We only have query operations and assignment. In other words, a binding operation. If you treat assignment as a binding of a value, then that is the only mutation that we are affording here. Now, this style is good just as a way of thinking anyway. It's a slightly more rigorous and mathematical and simpler to reason about. You're not taking a date and modifying it with side effect. But also, there's another thing that also I've noticed holds us back from embracing a more reasoned approach to thinking about stuff. We have such bad naming conventions. Get, I mean, really? The default meaning in English of get is an imperative. If you want to embrace functional programming, stop using imperative naming. Get is an assembler kind of thing. You see, look at a lot of code bases and you see what I call an object-oriented assembler. They're getting and setting things. It's like, no, what's the point of using a high-level language? Don't get anything. It just is or is not, you know? There is no get. So, you know, the default meaning in English of get is to have a side effect. If you doubt this, then go through a number of standard expressions. Get does not mean query. You know, when I go to a cash machine and I get money, there is a disappointing side effect on my bank account. Okay? It is not a query. If you get married, That's a fundamental state change in your life. Okay? It's not merely a query. Yeah? Would you like to get married? Is. But get married is actually a huge, great side effect based operation. Okay? It rebinds the pointer operations and all the rest of it. Okay? So, what does that mean? It means just name it for what it is. You know, it's the year, it's the month, it's the day and the month. That's it, direct. Okay, now sometimes people, when they're working with this style, sort of say, well, yeah, but sometimes I just want to take, I do want to take the date and I just want to modify one thing. Well, in which case, we would use a slightly different style. What we're going to do is a sort of projection style. I'm going to take that date, I just want to modify the year, and I get a new date back. Just as when you take the number 5 and you add 2 to it, you get 7 back. You don't change the value of 5. If you want to do that, go back to old Fortran. Yes, you could change the value of constants just by doing very naughty things. Don't do this. So this is basically the builder pattern. What it does is allows you to separate, present separate methods for constructing different parts of a complex object or performing cumulative changes to an object. Yeah. So if we do that, then it's a simple as creating that. In other words, we offer people a convenience to allow them to chain the stuff. We could potentially optimize it to avoid any additional validation that goes on in the constructor. But this idea, whichever way we look at it, simplifies the overall interface and usage. And the idea gives us sort of a chain-based model for reasoning, but it's a projection-based model. Here's a value. Here's how I transform the value. I don't change the original state of the object. And this is a this gives us a valuable property, which we're going to take back into the idea of concurrency. Bertrand Meyer noted that asking a question should not change the answer. Okay, we want to organize our code in terms of asking questions of values rather than telling them to do things. That said, I suspect that Bertrand Meyer, at the time he wrote this, did not have children. Because I've noted with my kids that asking the question always changes the answer. And asking it twice certainly does. But there's another aspect here. Asking a question should not change the answer, nor should asking it twice. This is the property of idempotence, the ability to use the same thing, the same query twice, and it has the same effect. Idempotens, same force. So we can kind of observe that what we're getting here is this idea of referential transparency. You know, desirable property implies functions consistently yield the same result given the same input. Function evaluation depends less, ideally not at all, on the side effects of mutable state. If it does this, this is going to aid us, not just in regular programming, but in the context of concurrency. So, okay, date is a fairly simple data structure, but a lot of people worry about their containers, because it turns out that most programs do not deal with one piece of data. They deal with lots. How do we organize the lots? So here's a very simple idea. Let us imagine a hypothetical library. The FTL. Faster than light. No, sadly. Well, actually, maybe. I presented warp drive yesterday in my talk. But a functional template library. What would the FTL look like, or what the STL look like, if we were to adopt functional ideas into it? Well, first of all, a lot of things have become simpler. Everything would be const qualified. You'd still be able to iterate. The only side effect operator on the containers would be to assign. And so I'm treating that as a rebinding operation. All iterators would be const. All value types, basically everything's const. Now, it turns out this is kind of easy to do. Here's a very simple idea, a set that we can go ahead and initialize. We can have a set of integers. Now, the great thing is that, thanks to initializer syntax, what I've now got here is that it's kind of easy because the set, because it's never going to change, you don't need to do, you know, silly tree arrangements. You can just say, right, here's an array, and the set is already ordered. During construction, the state changes, but a constructor is a transaction for completing a valid object. So basically, the constructor is the only place where state change is afforded. But by until the end of the constructor, you don't have a legal object. So therefore, what we're saying is that once it is fixed, it is fixed. That set, this is great for reference data, okay? So therefore, all of these operations can work on just a sorted array. This is really nice and simple, very compact, and a surprising number of uses of conventional modifiable sets will actually fall into this. We can have an array. which is actually somewhat, curiously enough, this is probably more useful than the standard array, which is actually slightly not useful. This is fixed size, but it's not fixed at compiler, at compile time. It's fixed at point of creation. Okay, you can get the front, the back, you can do all these various bits and pieces. Again, this satisfies a number of very common uses of arrays. Reference data, lookup data, data that's been passed around. Now, that's great, but maybe I want to push something or pop something. You're sitting there going, how's he going to do that? Well, that kind of width, that chaining approach is what we're going to use. Yeah, but isn't that going to be expensive? Well, if we do it naively, yes. But it turns out there's a class of data structures known as persistent data structures. And the idea of persistent data structure is that it actually supports the illusion of immutability. Even though things may apparently change, they don't change in a way that one person holding the value will notice. We'll take a value, we will push to it, and somebody else will have the pushed version, and this person will still have the version they originally had. They are seemingly isolated. So if you want to see what that looks like logically, by the way, don't confuse it with persistence as in databases. If we imagine that we have an array, underlying array, we can say, right, we've got a pointer to it, got another pointer to it, okay, B equals A, I can do a pop, okay? Now, C has a, so this is like a stack, basically. C now has three elements it can look at, whereas A is still looking at four. We haven't actually changed what A is looking at. We haven't changed the underlying data structure. We have merely used navigation to change the structure. That's great, but sometimes we would like to be able to push as well. It turns out there's another structure that allows us to do this. If we choose a linked structure, we've got A and C is pop A. We traverse the link. But importantly, the other thing is that now I can actually add. Now, here's the clever bit. This is the bit where there's, as I said earlier on, there's no magic. Okay? So what is it the magicians do? A magician uses sleight of hand. They make you look at this while something else is going on over here. So A is busy looking at this chain of four. Now I'm going to do a push. We're going to create a new link, a new node, but nobody's going to see it except D. A has no idea that's going on. Nobody can observe the fact there's a state change. It's as if it had always been there. And there's nothing you can do except look at everything executing at the instruction level to prove otherwise. It's as if it was always there. And this can tree out in memory. So let's see how we can take this. So let's try a vector. So a vector has slightly different capabilities to the STL vector because I want to stick with constant time operations. It turns out that a vector along these lines can support pop front and pop back, but it supports no operation. Now, I'm not wild about this naming idea because notice that's the imperative naming. I don't want to confuse it with the fact that it's not, I don't want to confuse it with the STL one because pop front in the STL has a side effect. I don't want to say this is like pop front, but it doesn't change the object. Well, then it's not like pop front, then, is it? This is popped front. Okay. So in other words, I'm going to use an adjectival sort of description of its state. I'm going to describe the state of what I am returning. This is the current object, but with the front popped. Okay. It's as if it were like this. Okay. So that's great. That's vector. What does list look like? Well, list is automatically going to be a lot more like a good old friend from the late 1950s. I happen to enjoy collecting old books, and this is from this is a reprint of a book from the early 60s, one of the original Lisp manuals. And I wrote about this one, and it's a very interesting book because it tells you how to create a Lisp interpreter. Because back then you couldn't really share stuff on GitHub, it turns out. So yeah, I made this observation in an article a decade and a half ago. As I said, I still have a deep fondness for the Lisp model. It is simple, elegant, and something with which all developers should have an infatuation at least once in their programming life. I'm no Lisp expert, but I've gone through two or three phases of thinking it's like the best way of thinking about stuff ever. There's a deep idea there. And I created a data structure in that article called Lisped. It was a Lisp-based list. I thought I was very clever for coming up with that. So here's my class list. It is naturally a forward list. It's a singly linked list. We're not going to worry about doubly linked lists. That's not a way I want to go. We've got a simple link structure. We've got the pop front, the push front, and all the rest of it. This is all great. And it works in the way that I described earlier on. This is fantastic. Now, there are two things. One is that that simple idea of illusion can be used, can be scaled up to trees. That idea is that we can have more sophisticated models. I'm going to stop here with a singly linked structure, but you can use this persistent data structure to deal with nodes, millions of items in a tree structure, and apparently return a whole new millions of nodes, except you're not. It turns out I'm going to return a structure where a couple of the nodes have changed and point in different places. Okay, and that's the idea. I'm not going to go further into that because there is one problem that we have at the moment. If you've been watching the slides really carefully, you will notice I have done absolutely nothing on memory management at all. It turns out Shakespeare was onto this. Shakespeare characterized the different philosophies of memory management in Hamlet. Okay? So in Hamlet, Hamlet observes, "Yea, from the table of my memory I'll wipe away all trivial fond records." Hamlet was a garbage collecting kind of guy. Okay, so it turns out that if you've got a garbage collector running, then, and C++ allows garbage collection to run, and even basic litter collection, it allows those to run. If you've got that to run, then my code just works fine, and it's simple, and it's good, and all the rest of it. There is only one small problem. Garbage collection is optional. There's no requirement that it exists. Now, this is unfortunate because it's one of those dangerous problems of trying to please all of the people all of the time. It turns out you can't do that because now I can no longer write a portable program that relies on garbage collection. The correctness, the operational behavior of that program now relies on an optional feature. You have to be incredibly careful of this. In other words, what we're effectively relying is that the pointer safety is strict. Perhaps we could get away with preferred, but we're relying on that. If that is not true, and trust me, it is not standard on C++ runtimes, if that is not true, then the correctness of our code has been undermined. All of our assumptions have been undermined. This is a problem with optional features. It actually means that although it looks like you can do more, actually you end up being able to do no more than you could before, which drives us into Ophelia's arms. "'Tis in my memory locked, and you yourself shall keep the key of it." Yeah, you get to do your own delete. Woo! Okay, so we don't really want to do our own delete. We're going to use reference counted, smart pointer, like shared pointer. There is a problem, and this was observed by Rob Murray back in 93, when everybody, back in the 90s, everybody was getting very excited about doing reference counted smart pointing. And it's just like, oh yeah, as he says, a use counted class is more complicated. Okay, well, fine. You might say, well, that's fine. I've got one in the standard library, a shared pointer, and if I'm not using C++ 11, onwards I can get one from Boost. Fine, there is a problem here. All this horsing around with use counts takes a significant amount of processing time. It does. Even in a multi-threaded program, you're also paying the cost of an atomic increment and decrement. So that's not necessarily a bad thing, it's just a thing you have to take into account, that this is not for free. But, okay, let's just say we take on that cost. We go ahead, we fix up the vector. Okay, we have to put our own deleter in because otherwise it will try and delete a single object rather than an array. So we think we're good. And we go for the list and we have shared pointers and we think we're good. And we think we solved the problem. I've got bad news for you. We've actually introduced a problem. You introduced a huge problem. I remember looking at this 15 years ago going, oh, this is not what I expected. This is most unfortunate. To understand this problem, I'm going to take, let's just fill up that list with a number of items. Okay, I'm going to front insert. We're just going to add in, I don't really care what the something is. We're just going to create a list. I want you to note where the curly brackets are. We're going to create a list, we're going to populate it, and then it's going to destruct at that closing curly. That destructor is going to automatically end up destructing the shared pointer. Right, which decrements from a reference count of 1, because we haven't shared it to anything, to 0, which means that the thing it's pointing at will now be deleted. the thing it's pointing at also has a shared pointer to another thing, which will drop the reference count from 1 to 0, and it will delete it. In other words, you will end up with a recursive delete. As I discovered, it turns out that this blows up your stack for surprisingly small values. If you want a list anything more than a couple of thousand long, you are screwed, to use a technical term. Okay? Now, some people sit there and think, oh, I've got a clever technique for this. I want you to stop right there. I don't doubt that you have. It's the fact that you need to do that that is the problem. It ultimately turns out, yes, garbage collection is ultimately far more superior for certain classes of architecture and programming than manual memory management. But manual memory management is not something we should be forcing on everybody. Okay? C++, optional garbage collection, no. It needs to become mandatory for the runtime, and then you can choose whether or not to opt in or out. Okay? And certain classes of software can have it disabled. Funnily enough, I made a claim, and I've just remembered this because Sean Parent is at this conference. We were on a panel about 10 years ago at C++ Connections in Las Vegas, and we were asked about the future of C++, and I said there are four things for C++ to be a proper systems programming language, in other words, be able to talk to its operating system and describe the capabilities of its platform and reflect those accurately. I said there are four features that it needs. Okay, one of those was threading. It's got that now, finally. Another one of those was garbage collection. A lot of runtimes have garbage collection. It's a standard feature, but not one that is accessible from C++. Another one was proper reflection, and the other one was a dynamic loading module system. 10 years on, we're almost halfway into that, but only just. So I'm going to point out that this is a kind of, if you really want to do proper functional programming with persistent data structures, you really need to start lobbying people for proper GC. We don't want more clever memory solutions. Okay, so what about the actual execution of this stuff? An observation from Russell Winder. Instead of using threads and shared memory as our programming model, we can use processes and message passing. Process here just means a protected independent state with executing code, not necessarily an operating system process. Now, the interesting thing is that he then gives a couple of examples. Languages such as Erlang, which uses the actor model, and Occam, which uses the CSP model before it, have shown processes are a very successful mechanism for programming concurrent and parallel systems. They don't have the stresses of synchronization, and they also scale rather nicely, and they're easy to reason about. Now, my background, funnily enough, many years ago, I did a master's degree in parallel computer systems, and the CSP, or the Occam model, is exactly what I used. And this is the thing that it kind of looks like. Okay, now some people kind of got into this idea of channel-based computing because of a more recent innovation, the Go programming language. But the point is that the channels is not a great new idea. So let's build up a simple channel model. It's a very simple channel model. I'm going to start off with the idea of a non-blocking receive and a send. Okay, so we're going to do that. I can do that, and I've got the idea that I can just have an underlying deck. My send is just a pushback, and yeah, I've got to do a little bit of work. My try receive, if it's empty, then you know we return false. If it's not empty, we pop, and the caller gets the value. Okay, that's really cool. It's also surprisingly sequential because I haven't put anything in there. Okay, so we obviously need to do something else. So I'm going to add in a lock. You can go and look up how to do lock-free versions and light locking versions of the rest of it. I just want to build up an encapsulated locking mechanism through an API. So we're going to do that. Fine. You have to put in a lock guard so that this does all the right thing for the send. And the try-receive becomes a little more complicated, but we've still got the basic thing going. So now try-receive, if it can get a lock, it'll get it. Otherwise, it returns false. If it can get a lock and it's the underlying channel is empty, then it'll return false. Otherwise, you actually get a value out of this. So this is the element of this. So building it up from sequential thinking, very modest sequential thinking, and then I probably will actually need, unfortunately, to add in a blocking receive, because actually, and logically, you should also, by the way, add in a timed receive as well. It turns out that it is, if you have, if all of your programming is composed of just try receives and timed receives, you can guarantee termination, which is kind of a nice property. However, the timed receive is a little noisier, so I'm going to leave that one to one side. But a blocking receive for those moments when really you have nothing else to do. We can go and add that, throw in a condition variable and notify all, and yeah, great. So I've got this slightly more involved version, but it gives me a nice abstraction. So what problem should we solve with it? Well, given that FizzBuzz was the problem I dealt with yesterday, let's go and do it again today. So FizzBuzz, for those of you that either were not here or cannot remember, because yesterday was a long time ago, simple counting, 1, 2, fizz, anything divisible by 3 is a fizz, 4, buzz, anything divisible by 5 is a buzz, okay? 13, 14, fizz, buzz, divisible by 3 and 5 is fizz, buzz. So not the world's hardest problem, but as a programming problem, it's normally defined over the domain of 1 to 100. So I can have a simple implementation of that, and we return fizz, buzz, you know, there's lots of different ways of doing this. Okay, now obviously this is such a real computation intensive thing, I'm going to set up a server for it. Here's my server, it's called a FizzBuzzer. And it infinitely serves FizzBuzz requests. How useful is that? Okay, don't say I didn't teach you anything today. So what I've got is I've got an input channel. This is where I receive my requests, I receive them, and I convert it to FizzBuzz and I send them on. Okay, that's cool. This is what main looks like. Yeah, we set up the two channels, we fire off a FizzBuzzer, and then we run through this. And we actually completely kill any point of doing concurrency whatsoever, but that's not really important. Okay, but the idea is we now have another thread running. It turns out that you can actually queue up things in advance. So let's actually talk about the asynchronous aspect here, because I'm doing it very synchronously, but the idea is I can actually send through a whole load of requests and pick them up later. From the point of view of the FizzBuzzer, the world is sequential. It's the property I described earlier on. It's trivial to test the correctness of this. You need no threads to test the correctness of the FizzBuzzer, or indeed of FizzBuzz itself. We've got a separation. The separation here is the core functionality. Here is the message handling functionality. And finally, we have the coordination, but I can test the messaging logic without needing that additional coordination. I can actually do all of the sends in advance, run this. I might have to limit it in a particular way. It runs infinitely, but the idea is I can test the logic in isolation. So these are kind of nice properties. Now, I can do a little bit of syntax sugaring. Instead of send and receive, I can use sort of stream operators, and I end up with a more elegant approach and one that is fairly familiar to people, and if they're coming from Go as well, that also gives them a certain familiarity. From the outside, then it looks a little bit like this. Okay, so we've built this up. Now, there is a little something missing here, is that if you look, the output, the send does a send, but what does the receive do? The other streaming operator appears to only support receive, the blocking one. What if I want to support the non-blocking one? Turns out that I can't do that at the operator level, but if I introduce a little proxy, I can do that. So the proxy will sense whether or not it's being used. If you need a bool conversion from it, then it'll use try receive. And if you don't need a bool conversion from it, then it'll do a blocking receive. So basically we're able to support it. I'm not going to linger on the code, but you're going to end up with something like that and then an internal class, nested class, that does all of that. I'm just putting that there for completeness. That's not the technique that I'm focusing on. But one final embellishment here. I want to focus on another feature. I said a moment ago that FizzBuzz is defined on the domain of over the domain of 1 to 100 normally. Let's support that. Let's be strict about that. So if you pass in a value 1 to 100, then you're good. If you pass in a value outside 1 to 100, then we're going to throw an exception. Threads and exceptions, how do we deal with it? Well, there is a model for dealing with this, but what I'm going to do is I'm going to change a few things here. The first thing I'm going to change is I'm going to change from channel of string as my return to channel of any. I could use a variant, but in this case I'm going to use any, one, because I invented any, and two, it's in next year's standard. I know, but I didn't invent it, so, Yeah, variant, you've got a correct variant is also in the standard. But any is the open protocol that I would use for any messaging anyway. So it also fits on the slide conveniently. So what we've got here is, what I'm going to do is I'm going to separate this out. I'm going to capture the current exception. And so basically, I'm either going to send out FizzBuzz, but if we get an exception, I'm going to capture the current exception as an exception pointer and send that back instead. And I can go ahead and I can pick that up. I can ignore it. I can pick up the result and say, hey, look, if it was a string, then I'm going to cast and get my result as a string, and I'm going to ignore any errors. And the error ignoring, I'm not comfortable with. But I also don't want to end up with a whole load of choreography in my core logic. So something else I can do, and this relates to a question that I was asked yesterday, something else that I can do is I'm going to add in an extra little feature. The extra little feature is I'm going to allow a channel to be constructed with a receive handler, a callback. Every time something is received, you get a callback on whatever you pass in. And you can use this to do a translation. On receive, you can do a simple filtering. If the receive type is an exception pointer, then rethrow the exception, which is quite nice, which means that the core logic looks like this. When you receive an exception now, it'll throw a domain error automatically. It propagates all exceptions out. So that allows me to separate the core logic. It's actually a little bit tidier than it was before. Exception handling is now separated from that. So we can keep on doing this and refine this, but there's a couple of final thoughts I want on this one. One, we can use this to build a pipes and filters architecture. Once you have a channel, you've got a pipe. A lot of problems break down nicely into the idea of, I compute something, I pass something on. I receive that, I pass it on. I receive that, I pass it on. I mean, the classic idea of pipes and filters is this idea of they are easily chained and very composable and very, very easy to reason about. The other thing is you can build towards the other thing that I studied during my master's degree, which was actor-based computing, which has become very popular recently. And I think probably the easiest way of reasoning about actor-based computing is to borrow from Andre's classic quote, multi-threading is just one damn thing after before or simultaneous with another. But actually the idea of actor-based computing realizes everything as purely sequential and hides the channel logic. Okay, actor-based concurrency is just one damn message after another. That's what you do. You just receive a message. You receive. You have a function that executes, and it just receives things, and then it may send things on. But you never even see the channels. You have the idea of communicating with objects in a very asynchronous and very natural way. So I'm going to bring this one to a close. I'm going to go back to John Carmack's observations, because the point here is that there's a lot of useful thinking. It's not simply a mutable state, it's isolation. But no matter what language you work in, programming in a functional style provides benefits. And you can sometimes, I'd say it's a continuum, you can move towards that by using mechanisms of true isolation and immutability. You should do it wherever it is convenient, and importantly, I like his idea of you should think hard about the decision when it isn't convenient. It goes back to my observation, the state modification and basically sharing mutable state and things like that. Consider those to be some kind of privilege, not a right. It's not a default that you should do. So this idea very much of making your state model explicit in a way that you can reason about is a very, very powerful concept. Don't throw it away. So to close, here's why I want you to think outside the synchronization quadrant. Because if you are synchronizing, you are blocking, you are waiting. And whilst there are some things in life that we do have to wait for, make sure that that is a natural consequence of the nature of the problem you are working on rather than accidental property of your architecture. Because the thing you always have to remember is all computers wait at the same speed. Thank you very much.
You spoke about this channel, the last theme, and it's highly resembling an active object paradigm. And actually, when you have too much of active objects, it's become like everyone passing message to any other. It become very cluttered and very hard to follow. Do you have some tricks to avoid this or something?
Right, yeah. The observation here is that
It turns out that if you have complex relationships in your code, that is your problem. Yeah? And channels will not save you from that. I don't think there's a problem with the active object paradigm. I think the problem that people have sometimes with active objects is that basically you can use it, just to clarify, an active object is an object that has its own internal thread and what it will need to do. And I'm not actually as, I used to be much more into active objects, but they're a lot easier with C++11. If you're using C++98, doing active objects is a little bit like sticking needles in your eyes, but not quite as much fun. But basically, the idea to create a default off-the-shelf channel, active object, you can use a channel internal to an object. The object runs with its own thread. It has a handler. And then what you're doing is every time you call a public function, you don't call that public function immediately. What happens is internally, using C++11, what you will do is capture the actual action of the function and put it into the channel as a queue. And then the processor will take it off and execute it. Okay? So you've got this kind of asynchrony and so on. If you need any results returned, that's where you use the futures. That's great, but actually it can get really quite complex if you're not careful, just internally. So this is why I tend to favor an actor-based approach, which is a lot lighter syntactically than that, and doesn't pretend to have public member functions. However, the basis of your question is that everybody can end up talking to everybody else. And I'm going to say, unfortunately, that is nothing to do with channels. That is nothing to do with using active objects. That is just to do with the basic choreography in your program, and that's the thing you need to challenge. You need to say, have I put the right responsibilities in the right place? For example, have I created a hub object that everybody has to go through? You know, there's a natural bottleneck. Or alternatively, the other end of the scale is, does everybody refer to everybody else genuinely, and therefore I have a complex web of objects? And, you know, there's a very good chance that I have other problems, like lifetime management problems and things like that. So normally there's a complexity there that will manifest itself in another way. And I want to go back to the opening slides that talk about this being an architectural problem. In other words, you have accidentally made significant decisions about how things go. So I think there's an important point here is that using a better abstraction for dealing with concurrency does not absolve you of any responsibility for still figuring out where the responsibilities for execution lie. And sometimes people do think that. They don't consciously think it, but sometimes think, oh, I've kind of solved what they consider to be the hard problem, and now they relax. Actually, it's a two-step problem. You've done the first step. Now, what are the right organizations of the abstractions? That becomes the challenge. Another question? Another thought?
Okay, so regarding the const containers and the problem with recursive destruction of Stack Overflow problem. So recently, Herb Sutter introduced his open source library to deal with this problem and using some magic, using allocators, transfer recursive call of destructors into iterative call. And this potentially may solve this problem with const containers. Did you look into it and consider it?
This fits into my observation that, yeah, we can come up with clever techniques, but the fact that we have to do that at all is a problem. Okay? It's a solvable problem. Putting it in a library does not make it a less solvable problem. It's a demonstration. Oh, yeah, it is a solvable problem, but you haven't actually really solved the root cause. What you've had to do is tell people, guess what? If you're going to do this, there's another special case you have to be concerned with. How many special cases do C++ programs already have to deal with between the top of a function and the bottom of a function? It's not that we cannot solve the problems, but one of the things that I find, particularly I deal with a lot of different programming languages, is that you can never just write a piece of code in C++. You always have to solve a fundamental computer science problem. Yeah? And you might say, oh, yeah, but it's fine. There's a library for that. Yeah, you have to know the library exists. So you have to go out and find it. Then you have to make a decision about the dependencies on that library. Dependencies do not come for free. And you now have a software architectural decision to make, whereas it's a non-decision in another context. So what I want to do is, I don't want to detract from Herb's work, because it's a demonstration that, yes, it is a solvable problem. And, yes, it's a known thing that I can turn all of those recursive things in. I can flatten them, and that's absolutely fine. It's just that, actually, we still have the problem. And actually, I have to do something else to get rid of the recursive calls as well. There's a lot of extra stuff I have to do to remember and keep that in mind. And it's not an optimization problem. I don't mind somebody saying, go to this library for fast allocators, because what we've got there is an optimization problem. Your code works, now you want it to work faster. We are actually dealing with the use of a library to change seemingly correct code into actually correct code, and that is the problem. So I think that the problem is still there. Yeah, it's not as easy. In fact, it's even harder to offer people advice than that. And I've already find that when it comes to shared pointer, you can't just tell people to use shared pointer. That's actually sometimes a really bad solution for a number of reasons. And so we cannot simply tell people just use shared pointer when you're sharing objects. It turns out that it's quite sophisticated, and that when to use such an allocator-based flattening is even harder. So I'm going to say that, yeah, we haven't really solved the problem. Yeah.
Hi. Don't you think that garbage collector once included will just spoil in C++ and we'll get something like Java?
Java's fine.
Okay, slow. Okay, but slow.
No, Java's not slow. That's a myth. You see, a lot of C++ people wander around going, Java's slow, we're fast. There is no such thing as fast and slow. You need to look at the class of application. If you go online, you will find loads of metrics where Java beats the hell out of C++. Okay? The idea that you know better than a well-defined garbage collector what to do is a complete myth. If you have a large object structure in memory, what happens when you delete the last shared pointer to it? When you delete the last shared pointer to it, the whole thing goes. If it contains a lot of memory and deals with a lot of small objects, you suddenly hit the deallocator really hard. You have a bottleneck. If you have a concurrent garbage collector, it amortizes the cost. You can't do that without garbage collection. Okay? So a lot of C++ developers are stuck in the 1990s as to their understanding of garbage collection. If you want to have fast concurrent systems and you want to have functional programming, you need garbage collection. If the idea of better programming is spoiling C++, then yeah, I want to spoil it. Yeah? But the idea that I can have runtimes, so for example, I cannot properly program the .NET runtime in C++ as a systems programming language. Okay? What kind of systems programming language doesn't allow you to access the facilities of the system? That's not a very complete language. You need a language that is able to talk to the system. The .NET runtime has a garbage collector. If I cannot talk to it meaningfully within the language, then we have a problem. Now, the other question is the optionality. I would like the option, a stronger option, not merely to say it's you run the program and guess what, you find out only at execution time whether or not you've got a garbage collector. I want to have the ability, except in specific environments such as embedded, okay? And even in embedded, let me think, what is embedded these days? Apparently embedded is far larger than the computers that I used to work on in embedded systems, and they involve garbage collectors. So I want to have this capability. But in certain classes of software, I want to be able to disable that, and that's fine. But the default, you don't have a garbage collector. That thinking has to go. It is 2016. I think it's time for people to grow up. Okay? Cheers.
Thank you very much. Kevlin Henney.